In today's khutba, I would like to discuss ayat number 178 of Surah Aale Imran. But before that, just to connect that with the situation that we see in Bahrain at the moment, according to the news item that we have received from Majlis Ulama Shia of Europe, recently a court in Bahrain has sentenced 13 Shias to life in prison for their role in the anti-regime protest in March of 2012. As you know that, you know, these protests were there by the Shias who are in the majority in Bahrain, and most of the protests were peaceful. There were no arms or violence used. And this is where we see that, you know, the Western world, especially America and Canada, which talks about democracy all the time, they really have not said anything serious about the anti-democratic measures taken by the Bahraini regime. Because, you know, they look at their own geopolitical interest. Democracy is just a card played whenever it suits them. But let me go to another perspective of such events, where even some Shias, and I'm sure many even in Bahrain, ask this question, that, oh Allah, how long will you allow this to continue? Even the Iraqis during the day of Saddam used to ask this question. There are two different ways of, you know, answering that. One would be that from the Islamic perspective, we know that this dunya is darul bala. This is the abode of test and trial. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was supposed to intervene in all situations, then there would be no sense in the test and trial. You know, you look at Karbala. Even there you can ask this question, oh Allah, you know, it happened there. The grandson of the Prophet killed in this brutal manner, but you didn't do anything. Well, you know, he says, I'm watching. This dunya is a place of test and trial. The oppressor is being tested. The oppressed is also being tested. The rich is being tested. The poor also is being tested. Those who are healthy and capable, they are being tested in one way. Those who are sick and not that much capable, they are being tested. So everyone in different situation is going through imtihan and ibtila. For us, the results would be at the end. But even when we talk about the zalimeen, we had to realize that this ayat from Surah Ali Imran, ayat number 178, not everything, you know, the result will be left for the day of Qiyamah. There are situations where we see the results in this dunya itself. And this is an ayat which was actually recited by Sayyida Zainab bint Ali, salawatullah alayh. In the khutbah that she gave in the darbar of Yazid, very much, you know, fitting in this situation where you have Yazid in his arrogance, pride, you know, very happy with his victory. And she recites this ayat, وَلَا يَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّمَا نُمْلِ لَهُمْ خَيْرٌ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ. That those who disbelieve, they should not assume that the respite, the chance that Allah has granted to them is good for them. إِنَّمَا نُمْلِ لَهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we give respite sometimes to them, لِيَزْدَادُ إِثْمًا, so that eventually they will end up doing even more sins, and that will give him more, you know, right to punish them even severely, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُحِينٌ, and they will be afflicted with humiliating punishment. And this is the ayah that Zainab is reciting there, applying that on Yazid, that you are being arrogant, you are assuming that Allah has given you victory, but, you know, if you have a respite at the moment, don't think Allah is happy with you. Because sometimes they take it as a sign, oh, it means I am okay, what I'm doing. And this is what Yazid had taught initially. By killing Imam Hussein alayhi salam and taking his family members as prisoners and parading them in the streets of Kufa and Damascus, you know, he thought he has gained, you know, success and guaranteed the survival of his regime. Very soon he came to realize that it's actually the opposite. By doing what he did, he actually brought about the fall of the Sufyani dynasty. Yes, Umayyad rule continued, but not in the line of Abu Sufyan. The son of Yazid himself refused to continue. He says, I cannot be part of what has happened. And therefore, another line from Banu Umayyah, the Ali Marwan, came into power. And this is where we see that, you know, this was there, right there, within few years after the events of Karbala, even during our own time. Especially those who suffer in these situations, they should always look at this ayat and always remember the example of the past, but even the examples of our own time. You know, look at the case of Marcos of the Philippines, Shah of Iran, Radovan Karadzic, the butcher of Bosnia, Saddam of Iraq, Mubarak of Egypt. These are all examples, living examples of our own time. That these were people very powerful. They had wealth and power and armies, everything at this disposal. But a time came when they had humiliating defeat and punishment. And so not everything is left for the day of Qiyamah. You know, they even see the results here. But it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who says that if we give them respite, muhlat, you know, it shouldn't be considered that this is for their good. No. Eventually, they will have adabun muheen. And that is, in a way, you know, something that people can keep with themselves, especially the mazloom. It doesn't mean they should not work, you know, to get rid of the zalimeen, but, you know, the hope is there that a time will come when zalimeen will face justice in this dunya as well as the akhirah, inshallah. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وعلى آله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة مما سلف من ذنوبكم. When we talk about this process of zalimeen having given the respite and the muhlat or the time and that Muslimin have to still struggle. But even in their struggle, they have to always maintain the haq and the justice. There is a statement from Amir al-Mu'min where he says that if I had to play politics, I could have done it better than Muawiyah. But there is a difference between haq and batil. You know, Amir al-Mu'minin could not use the deceiving methods used by Muawiyah. And so there is a big difference between what is known as siyasat-e-umawi and siyasat-e-alawi. The politics of Ali and Alawis, you know, has restrictions and limitations. They cannot, you know, be politicians in the 100% of the sense that, you know, for them, power becomes the end result of everything. Amir al-Mu'minin in different khutbas talks about it. You know, he says government and this power is not actually the aim. This is actually a means to impart justice and peace in the society. And that is the difference between the siyasat umavi. For them, to get power is the end. Whereas from Amir al-Mu'minin, government and power is actually a means to a noble goal. And that is what we have to always keep in mind, that, you know, it is better to be mazloom, but be on haq and adl, then become zalim by the means which are not justified. Let me now go on to another ayat again, since we had this wafat of Bibi Zainab yesterday. Another ayat she used in the khutbah, which is more on a personal level, which of course was very, you know, fitting in that situation for Yazid. And this is from Surah Ar-Rum, ayat number 10, where she says, ثُمَّ كَانَ عَاقِبَةَ الَّذِينَ أَسَاءُ السُّوءُ أَنْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَكَانُوا بِهَا يَسْتَحْزِيُونَ. That those, the end of those who commit sins, what happens to them at the end? أَنْ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, they reject the verses of the Quran. وَكَانُوا بِهَا يَسْتَحْزِيُونَ, they actually ridicule the ayat of Quran. That is the end result of, you know, going into deep into sins. Each one of us, every human being coming to this dunya is born with a light within. They have this built-in capability of seeking guidance and seeing the way. Unfortunately, when sins come in, and this is especially for those who are already on the path, and if a person commits sins again and again and again and doesn't amend his or her life and ways, doesn't ask forgiveness, what happens at the end? In a symbolic sense, according to the hadith of our sixth imam, he says, when the sins start accumulating and you don't use the method of tawbah to erase that, it's just like your soul is gradually being accumulated with dots on it. And your soul is lit initially. But when one sin is committed, there is a black dot on it. When second one comes in, another second dot. And if a person does not go through this process of erasing them through tawbah and istighfar and amending themselves, what happens? Eventually, the whole soul is covered with sins. Although the light is still in there, but it's not going to show the way, because it is covered with sins. And this is where we see in Surah number 83, ayat 14, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلْ كَانَ عَلَىٰ بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ كَانُوا مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. That these are the people, referring to the evil people, he says, what has happened to them? The sins that they have accumulated has rusted on their hearts. We're not talking about a physical heart here. We're talking about the soul, the spiritual heart. And when the sins accumulate, it becomes like a rust on it. And this is where, you know, this is a spiritual heart attack. It will seize the soul. And there will be no light anymore there. And so the end result, according to this ayat, is that they will start even rejecting the ayat of Quran. Or they will say, you know, what is this? 1400 years old book is irrelevant during our times. You know, they start ridiculing the laws of the Quran and what the Prophet has said. And this is where we have to realize that, yes, study the Quran. If you don't understand, think about it, ponder on it, ask questions, do research. But you're not allowed to reject the ayat of Quran or ridicule the ayat of the Quran, because you have not been able to understand that. And this is something that we have to realize, that when we talk about, you know, spiritual self-building, this process of taharat of the nafs and the soul is very important. Otherwise, the sins can accumulate And nauzubillah, if a person reaches to that state, there is nothing which can help that individual. And so keep in mind that, you know, Bibi Zainab was applying this ayat on Yazid, that you are here out of your arrogance and because the sins that you have, you know, accumulated, now you are even challenging the revelation of the Quran, the poetry that he recited at that time, which was not from him, but from some of the mushrikeen, enemies of the Prophet, where he says, لَعِبَتْ حَاشِمٌ بِالْمُلْكِ فَلَا خَبَرٌ جَاءَ وَلَا وَحْيٌ نَظَلٌ. Just think about it. Somebody is sitting on the seat of Khilafat of Rasulullah. And what he's saying, that the Banu Hashim family has actually staged a drama. There was no news from the heavens and there was no revelation which came down. Sitting there is Khalifat Muslimin rejecting the Quran. You know, doubting the claim of Rasulullah that I have brought the Quran. And the result, this is the result of what the ayat says, asa'u su, you know, they accumulated the sins. And so when we talk about our own, you know, spiritual journey, we have to constantly be aware of this problem. And this is where tawbah and istighfar is there. Our life is of struggle. None of us is infallible. You know, we have to constantly struggle. And whenever mistakes are done, sins are committed, you know, always be remorseful and ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, if you look at the sajda that we do, Amir al-Mu'minin was asked about the symbolism of sajda. And very beautifully he says, when you go into the first sajda, you are reminded of your origin. When you place your forehead on the earth, that this is what you have been created from. When you get up from the first sajda, that is symbol of your birth. When you go into the second sajda, that is a symbol of your death. This is where you will be put back. When you get up from the second sajda, Ali says, this is symbol of your day of resurrection. You will be brought back to life. And when you see the symbolism of sajda, then think about it now. Between the birth and death, how many seconds we sit? Between the two sajdas, not even a minute. And so our life actually is very, very short. But during that short time, what do we recite? Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayh. Our life is nothing but struggling to obey Allah and constantly doing tawbah and istighfar. And that is how we'll be able to keep this spiritual dirt away from our soul, and we will be able to see the light forward, inshallah. Allahumma salli ala sayyid al-mursaleen wa shafi al-mudhunibin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Wa ala imam al-muttaqeen wa amir al-mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullah alayhi. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين بن محمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان محيا صار البدو والطغيان هادم يا أمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فرول البغي والشقاق صلوات الله والسلام عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون